I'll call the regular meeting to order. To make it easier for residents to voice their comments, there will be two public comment periods. There will be one at the beginning of the meeting designated for comments related to items on the agenda, and one at the end of the meeting for general public comment. Public comment for designated public hearing items will be heard when the item is called. Speakers will be limited to 3 minutes to state their comments. This meeting is being video recorded and streamed live on the internet. Mr. Valdez, please confirm posting and roll call.
Mayor, this meeting has been posted in accordance with the Nevada Open Meeting Law. All members of the council are present and you have a quorum.
Thank you. I would like to invite Amy Johnson from the City Clerk's Office to the podium to give the invocation followed by the Pledge of Allegiance.
Heavenly Father, thank you for this beautiful spring day. Thank you for the opportunity to meet in this place and hear from diverse individuals on important topics. Please bless that those here today will act as good stewards over the responsibilities given to them. Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Now is the time for our first public comment. Before we begin, the city clerk will make an announcement.
All communications with the city council and staff using email, text messages, and social media platforms is subject to the Nevada Public Records Act and the Nevada Open Meeting Law on all personal and city-issued devices. Please set your electronic devices to silent starting now. The city council is legally limited in their ability to respond to public comment. Questions and requests from the public will be referred to the appropriate city department for their review. Please do not sit, stand, or block the aisles, walkways, or doorways. And as a reminder, the vestibule at the back of the chambers is reserved for working city staff and public safety personnel only. For persons requiring ADA accommodations, please contact a deputy city clerk for assistance. To participate in public comment, please register your name and zip code with the clerk managing the public comment queue at the back table in the vestibule. Please note that public comment during meetings is reserved for designated public hearing items only. When your name is called, please stand in front of the podium and speak directly into the microphone. Please remember to state your first and last name for the record. You will have 3 minutes to speak, and Mayor, in the public comment queue, no one has registered.
Thank you. I'll close the public comment period. Mr. Derrick, are there any changes to the agenda?
There are no changes, Your Honor.
Thank you. May I have a motion to accept the agenda as presented?
I'll move.
Please vote.
All council members voted in favor of the motion made by Councilman Seebach, and it carries.
The first section of the agenda is proclamations, commendations, and presentations. Our first item is a recognition of four members of the Henderson Police Department for their heroic efforts. On Sunday, March 10th, Henderson police officers responded to a structure fire with visible flames, exploding glass, and heavy black smoke billowing from a second floor residence. Learning that residents were trapped inside, the responding officers intervened without hesitation, breaching the front door and fighting through the thick smoke and flames to save the lives of an 8-year-old child and 2 family pets. The Henderson Fire Department arrived within minutes, evacuated nearby residents, and extinguished the fire. It is our honor to recognize police officers Austin Church, Brandon Delabelle, Angelo Gomez, and Wyatt Hallett for their exceptional courage, professionalism, and life-saving efforts during this incident. Our Henderson Police Department is a premier law enforcement agency, and the selfless actions of these officers reflect the highest standards of duty and compassion. I'd like to invite Officers Church, Delabelle, Gomez, and Hallett to the, and Police Officer Holly Chadwick, to join the Mayor and Council in the gallery.
email using your chief voice? You want me to talk? Oh, I told him you could do it all. Well, as you guys know, we are always proud of our officers, but we're really grateful on this one. Not only were they able to take action very quickly, but they saved a life of a young child and also went back looking for more and were able to save the family animals that were part of that house. But the most important thing was, and you'll see later tonight when we push out the video of them rescuing that young child who was screaming for help and screaming for their parents. So it's amazing what they do. They don't like public accolades. They get very shy and quiet in public. But these are the things they do behind the scenes each and every day that we don't always know about to save lives. And they are heroes, and they're mine, and I love them, and I'm grateful to have them.
So public safety is one of our strategic priorities in the city, and these guys standing up here are the reason why we are so successful at it. We are proud as a council and as mayor every day of the work that our public safety officers do to protect and defend our residents. It is important work, and a lot of times it goes unnoticed or unthanked, and we could not let this opportunity pass by. This was an extraordinary effort you all made to save this child's life. You changed an entire family. And sorry, I have an 8-year-old grandson. So thank you for what you've done. Thank you for the example you set. Thank you for being a member of the HPD. We could not be more proud of you. We appreciate the work you've done, and I've got a certificate for each one of you.
Our next item is a proclamation declaring the week of April 21st as National Crime Victims' Rights Week. Established in 1981, National Crime Victims' Rights Week is an annual commemoration that promotes victims' rights and services. This observation provides an opportunity for the City of Henderson to join cities across the nation in honoring victims of crime and educating residents of services provided by our city's victim advocates. Chief Chadwick, members of the Henderson Police Department, and Safe House Executive Director Beth Flory are invited to the gallery to accept the proclamation.
I want to take a minute to recognize our victim and witness advocates from our police department and our city attorney's office. They do an amazing job every day of making sure that people who have been injured or have been misused in some way are protected and represented, and they have a voice, and it's so important. And for Safe House, for all you do, for those in our community who have had a really tough time. You do everything you can to protect them and to get them into safety and to make sure that they can move on in a better manner than they arrived. So thank you. It's my honor on behalf of Council to present this proclamation declaring this National Crime Victims' Rights Week. Thank you very much.
So, almost exactly 30 years ago, Safe House was founded by a group of amazing community partners right here in Henderson. One of those individuals is the Honorable Judge Ken Proctor, who unfortunately is no longer with us, who the park across the street is actually named after, Proctor Judicial Park. Since that time, we've helped over 100,000 victims of domestic violence through counseling, education, advocacy, and emergency shelter, as well as victims of sexual assault and victims of human trafficking. We've had a partnership with the Henderson Police Department since 1997, and we've also gotten considerable support from the City of Henderson through funding such as the Henderson CDBG Block Grant. So I can't thank Henderson enough for being such a great host of our organization, and we look forward to helping many more victims of crime beyond this week, and thank all of those lawmakers who've really moved the needle for victims of crime in our state. And I want to thank the Henderson Police Department for all your support and your amazing partnership as well.
Our next item is a presentation by the City of Henderson's appointed member to the Clark County School District Board of Trustees. During the 2023 legislative session, Assembly Bill 175 was passed, requiring the City of Henderson to appoint a non-voting member of the Clark County School District Board of Trustees. Last October, Council appointed Ramona Esparza Stoffergren to represent the City of Henderson, and she is here to share an update of recent CCSD board activities. Welcome, Ramona.
Thank you. I really appreciate the opportunity to be sharing with you today, and I know my time is brief. Let me make sure I know how to change that. Great. I first want to acknowledge the immense support from the mayor and from the council members here. The amount of resources and the amount of onboarding and the training that I received has been just unsurmountable, and I want to thank you personally. I also want to acknowledge your government community relations team, your educational team, they're also here with us today, and your legal team. I had the opportunity to meet with each of your divisions and departments prior to me being sworn in my oath of office. It was very informative. I was able to really understand the needs of the community, the services that are provided, and I really want to align with the strategic plan and the educational initiatives that we have here in the City of Henderson, the community that I love and live. So I will say some things that have been very interesting with the onboarding. In addition to Henderson providing training, I did receive additional training from the Nevada Association of School Board. And I also did receive training from the CCSD. So I wanted you just to kind of be aware. I had an opportunity to attend the legislative day in Washington, D.C. with some of my fellow trustees, and we were able to meet with some of the elects to have conversation about some of the initiatives at the federal and at the state and at the local the concerns that we have with educational needs. I'm also continuing the training that I'm receiving. As a requirement of being a trustee, we are required to have 6 hours of professional learning in our first and third year. I wanted you just to kind of see the scope of communication that is happening, and I'm trying to be a public servant to our community. We do have, I won't read these to you, but there is quite a bit of meetings, as you are well aware, in the service that you do for our community, which we're grateful for. So I do want you to kind of know the amount of time that I'm engaging with our community as well. One of the things that I'm very responsive to is interacting with my other appointed trustees, and we do meet on the monthly, in addition to with the voting trustees and the elected trustees. I am very aware in making sure that I'm trying to be visible for events that I'm asked to participate in. And I'm also trying to definitely be a bridge for our higher education. So I want you to see that we attended and provided some training to student leaders at UNLV in the past 2 weeks. And I was wearing multiple hats, but it was something that I love because our leaders of the next generation need to have that kind of interaction. This particular picture was at an event last week. Some of our schools were represented, and I'll tell you what it was all about. It was the second annual Miracle Mind Student Mental Health Conference. And two of our schools were given awards for their ability to provide services for students, and that was Brown Junior High and Basic High School. The thing that I want to really focus on my time today with you is we have many important equal initiatives in our educational sphere here in the city of Henderson, but what I'd rather do in my quarterly reports is to focus on a few at a time. What I would like to say is that I'm going to share some information that has been presented to us as board members so that you have updates on some of the reports that we're being given, because I know that you may not have access to all of the information that I'm consuming at this time. So the two areas that I'd like to focus on is the outreach with our families to understand their needs, which is 1.2 initiatives here in Henderson, and then 4.2 is advocating for community efforts to support safe school environments and prevent youth violence. So looking and according to our strategic plan, really in the past 3.5 months, I know it's hard to believe, I've been there for a short time, I really want to focus on wraparound services for our students in the city of Henderson. You may not be aware that ESSER funding is sunsetting in the fall of September 2024 of this coming year. And so schools are having to provide those types of wraparound services and fund that from their site-based budgets that they haven't had to do that before. So what I want to just bring to our attention is that we have been really advocating for our students to not have that be discontinued. And at a board meeting, our interim superintendent did mention that they are going to revisit that ask that we are hopefully having our schools not to have to pay for example, Care Solace or Hazel Health Services. One of the areas that they're not able to fund at this time is the mental health clinics. And there are certain middle schools and high schools that are going to use their site-based funding to do so, but there are some of our schools in Henderson that do not have the money to do that. So I just wanted to bring that to your attention, that that's an area that we should consider and our students definitely need, and it affects their ability to feel safe in the schools and for them to return to schools. One of the reports that was also presented to us was student discipline data. And I know that was a presentation that I witnessed here, talking about they've seen an escalation of behaviors in the middle school. One of the things that I wanted to kind of bring and get really more granular with is the fact that we need to really provide training. And one of the asks that we've asked is, what is happening for the personnel on staff? They are going to be training campus security monitors and de-escalation skills. They're also going to be definitely implementing a new plan to allow schools to opt in to have cell phones to be placed into a pouch and it will be secured. So schools will have that as an option at the secondary level, which would be middle and high school, so that students can be focused on instruction. And a lot of times when they have access to those devices, there can be social interactions that are not positive. There can be bullying. There can be just escalation of situations So they're really focusing on resolving conflicts and being more proactive with some of the conversations that we've had. The one thing I do want to say that I really want to emphasize is we need to have a conversation about having a highly qualified teacher in every classroom. Teacher vacancies is not acceptable. It's an ongoing conversation that we're having to really understand that students need to have a sense of belonging. They need to have a connection with an adult, and that's going to be helping to reduce the reduction of them not attending school. When they feel like they belong to theater, or they belong to band, or they're in chess club, that's something that we're going to make sure that we have that consistent adult in their lives for them to return to school on a daily basis. The district average, when we look at chronic absenteeism, is 30%, but for the city of Henderson, we're at 20%. So work to be done, but we are doing the right things. And I will say, as your representative, I'm asking very hard questions, and we're digging into the data for that. Moving on, I just want to share some quick observations, and these are personal observations that I'm going to say in my short time. We, through the dynamics of being within a new group, we are very much asking about the systems and the processes and the data that's being shown to us. I will say that I've seen personally a shift in some of the culture within the group, and we also have conversations that we are going to definitely revise the data reports. So that's been an ongoing ask, and I know that that's a conversation that we hear you loud and clear, that that is something that we need to do better. The other thing that I really am focused on is building those relationships with my fellow trustees and really trying to create that connection so that we can address concerns and issues and be more proactive versus reactive when things are coming to us as a board. And then just last, to acknowledge that anytime you add new to an existing culture and group, there is definitely some norming that is happening. So please, in time, I'm very, very optimistic that we are making progress and we're moving forward in the right direction. Next steps, we are currently in the process of putting out an RFP to look for a new superintendent. And we are engaged with a consultant, a Council of Great City Schools, to do some future community listening tours to identify not just their needs, but also what do they want to see in their next leader within the district. The other thing that we are going to be charged with is reviewing the vision and the strategic plan to improve student achievement, because that's why we're all here, to service our kids and make sure those outcomes look different. The last three are really personal goals for myself. In my time that I've been here serving in this role, I really want to expand my reach, specifically in the city of Henderson. And I want to make sure that I'm listening to individuals and what can we do better. I also want to make sure that I continue to attend events. I'm dressed in this attire today because I'm going to the Starlight Award to honor 800 of our employees, and some of them will be selected as finalists for their amazing work that they do every day. So I'm kind of in my different attire today. And then I do plan with my fellow trustees in Henderson, Trustee Linda Cavazos and Trustee Lisa Guzman. I'm planning to do some school-based visits with them together. And I believe I have time for questions.
My first question, well, thank you. First of all, thank you for the work that you're doing. Thank you for being a voice for Henderson, and I think elevating the conversation that we're having at the school board level. I think you bring a unique perspective and breadth of knowledge to that board that I think if they incorporate some of the things that you're talking about, we'll just elevate it to the next level. I have a couple of comments and then a question. The question is, you mentioned the Hazel Health Services and the mental health clinics and the lack of funding or the stop funding for those. Where did the money originally come from? Is it something we get? Is it federal money that we're not getting? And can we help advocate for that funding?
Thank you, Mayor Romero. I really appreciate that. So, yes, the original funding was told to us that it was ESSER funding, so it was federal funds due to COVID. So that will sunset, and they did allow schools to have the option to purchase. I will say to you that they are revisiting potential other funding sources for Hazel House and Care Solace. The one that they're telling schools they do not have funding is for the United Citizens Foundation, which is the Miracle Minds therapy, which provides 2 to 3 days a week therapy for students on site. And it's more at the secondary level that I'm aware of in the city of Henderson.
Okay. Whatever you need us to do to help advocate for that, we will do so. And I believe we've had discussions too, Nicole would know better than I, about making sure that we are able to reimburse through Medicaid for those types of services to keep those services in schools. So that's something important that we will absolutely support for you. Recently, the council and I have met with, I've met with the five-star schools, and the council has met with principals in our schools. And one of the things that has consistently come up is chronic absenteeism and the detrimental effect that is having on students and on teachers in the classroom. And one of the things that I discussed with the five-star schools, what were they doing differently? They still have some chronic absentee problems, but they seem to be doing a little bit better in that area than some of the other schools. And what they told me was that their engagement with parents has been elevated, and they feel like through a variety of very kind of ingenious things, not necessarily schoolwork related, but maybe with sports and other things, they've been able to bring families and parents in to be more participatory in the school experience, and that has helped a great deal. So whatever we can do to help put that message out or help you in your efforts to reduce that chronic absenteeism, get kids in classes, and help the teachers and the administrators for the schools, we're happy to do that. Also, I'd like to offer, as far as improving safety, in the past we have reached out to CCSD, safety, police department, and offered to do coordinated training with them. That offer is always on the table. Oftentimes our police department would be the first to respond if there was an emergency. And we would like them to be able to work seamlessly together in an emergency. We don't want to waste any time. So we would really love it if they would be more open to that coordinated effort, so we know where they enter, where the keys are, where, you know, important things are for the school, so that it's not a guessing game once they get there. And then my final comment is, thank you for working on changing the reporting. We have been frustrated for a very long time about the quality of the information we're getting in reports and the somewhat sugar-coated information that we get, and we would really appreciate just, these are the facts, this is our baseline, this is where we need to work, and this is how we're going to get there with benchmarking along the way. So thank you so much. And with that, I'll turn it over to my fellow council for comments.
Mayor, if I might. Mm-hmm. One word, my first comment is hope. You've actually came and there's a ray of sunshine. I just felt hope with your report and the process in which you're involved in. I want to thank you for, I know you made it very politically correct. A new situation is always tough. It's been, let's just say, very, very, very difficult for the four of you appointed. So thank you very much for being tough and seeing your way through that, because I think this is going to pay great dividends for the city of Henderson. And thought came to me when we first started talking about this, it was that, oh, okay, we have a voice into the CCSD and the Board of Trustees. And it didn't really occur to me, I'm kind of slow, but it really didn't occur to me that we also have a voice to hear what we as a city can do better with this, even though we don't have any jurisdiction over the schools, what we can do better, and maybe some programs we can help fund and those kind of things. I think this is a wonderful two-way communication that I hadn't really thought about until your report, so I appreciate that, and all I can say is hang in there. We appreciate what you're doing.
Thank you.
I just have to say, I know what it's like to be the new kid on the block. So it's great that you have taken just a great stance in your attitude and in your welcome, you know, you're welcoming them to participate with you. You're reaching out. I think that's phenomenal. I'd love to hear more about the shifting culture and what is taking place to make that happen for a positive movement forward.
Thank you, Councilman Cox. You know, I'm a, I will say to you that it's leading with inquiry. It's leading with a lot of questions to really seek those that have institutional knowledge in the roles that they've been in, and also really seeing everyone that comes to the table that has strengths. They all have different strengths. So I think that openness and really trying to dig into, that's my goal, is that we can work and move forward together and do things better. Streamlining, there's some streamlining and efficiency that I'm seeing as a former, you know, high school principal and had various different roles. I was a data coordinator. I was in different facets of the district. And I think that's the difference for me, to be able to bring some of that institutional knowledge. And I think others are seeking that from me as well. So we're it's a two-way exchange communication that and leading with that kind of leading questions and openness.
That's wonderful. Mm-hmm. And I know that, and the mayor already touched on this, but when I met with the principals in Ward 3, it was interesting, and I think a lot of us had the same experiences with the principals in that they were trying to find out how to better address chronic absenteeism. And I loved what Bestie McDaniel's doing and that they're making phone calls. Yeah. They're making connections with those parents. Yeah. And I'm wondering if how much influence does the school board have on directing schools to do certain techniques that actually work. Mm-hmm. Is there a way that the school board can come up with something that, hey, we've looked at school A, B, C, and D, and this is what's working best, and we want our schools to try this? Because I know that there's still some autonomy. Obviously, principals like autonomy, and their schools are different. But is there a way to put that into policy when you find out what's working best to address absenteeism?
And thank you for that question. So I will say to you that I think it's showcasing what's working and looking at really what are those strategies and really getting into the weeds of what are they doing different. And so I think you're right. Every community is very unique. And so we can't make assumptions that what may work for one may not be in the other. So I think I appreciate that the council even brings principals together. They have shared that that is very helpful and appreciative. I will say to you that I know that I have the trust from individuals, even to coach them through talking, how can we, you know, have a positive interaction, because we are very passionate about serving communities and we're passionate about making sure our kids are succeeding. So I'm very grateful to be asked to serve in this capacity, because I feel that I can share and also showcase and be a conduit for those that are doing things that we need to highlight.
That's awesome. Well, my last thing is just to thank you so much for being there, for accepting the appointment, and for doing a great job. Truly, I am so grateful.
Thank you.
Okay. First of all, I want to thank you for serving. That's very kind of you, and we recognize the sacrifices that you have to make in order to do that. And also, I'm very impressed with your leadership skill, that you've recognized that there is a role, that you can be a leader there, and you can work with others and hopefully be an agent for change. And we appreciate the start that you've got. We want you to know that we're behind you, and we're happy to help you in any way that we can. And we appreciate the open communication. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Councilman Shaw. I'm very grateful. Like I said, your team is amazing. Amazing. I can't say enough about the supports I've been given.
The only thing I'd like to add is a few things. One, you're 100% right. We have a fantastic team here that is there to support you. And also, I want to what I would ask of you is, as you move forward, is to really question their answers that they give you, and then bring forth. You don't have to wait for the quarterly. If there's things that the city can do to help improve the education, especially here in the city of Henderson, please let us know. Whether it's the programs like the mayor was bringing up, whether it's after school, crossing guard, whatever it is, please bring that to our attention so we can get on it as appropriately and as quickly as possible in regards to that. Because what you're finding out is making a tremendous difference, and you have a whole team that's very capable to help support that. And the last thing I want to do is say thanks, because that one slide you showed about communication, that's above and beyond what you've been signed up for, and I've seen you all over the place in a short amount of time, and so I just want to thank you for your dedication and jumping in with both feet, so thank you very much.
Thank you, Councilman.
Thank you, Ramona, and we hope that we're hoping for a successful outcome in our efforts to make sure that your full role as a trustee is respected. So thank you so much for coming.
Thank you for having me. I'm very grateful.
Mayor, this section of your agenda is the city manager's report. The city of Henderson was recently named a recipient of the Government Finance Officers Association Triple Crown Award for fiscal year 22. This recognition of excellence in public finance is made possible by our finance team and their thorough dedication to financial reporting and industry-wide best practices. Congratulations to Director Maria Gamboa, Deputy Director David Weiser, and the finance team on this great achievement. Next week is National Volunteer Week. We are thankful for the hundreds of community members who donate their time and talents to our city. Last year, nearly 1,900 volunteers donated more than 74,000 hours of their time, saving the city over $2 million. Your efforts truly help make Henderson a place to call home. And finally, Mayor, it's my honor to announce the retirement of Sabas Alonzo from IT. Thank you for your dedicated service to our city. We wish you the very best. And that concludes the city manager's report. Mayor, the next section of your agenda is the consent agenda, consisting of items 5 through 30. Unless an item is pulled for discussion, council will take action on all items with one motion, accepting the recommendations as stated on the agenda item.
Thank you, Mr. Derrick. May I have a motion to accept the consent agenda as presented? Please vote.
All council members voted in favor of the motion made by Councilman Seebach, and it carries.
The next section of the agenda is public hearings. Item 31 is a public hearing for Teamsters Blue Collar Labor Agreement for Teamsters Local 14. Your recommendation is to approve.
Good afternoon, Mayor and Council. My name is Brooke Stream, Director of Human Resources for the record. Item 31 is a public hearing regarding approval of the labor agreement between our Teamsters Blue Collar with the City of Henderson and Teamsters Local 14. It's for a two-year period starting on July 1st of 2023 through June 30th of 2025. So the labor agreement includes a few things, an increase in wages based upon the consumer price index formula that's in Article 4. It's the annual rate in the West Size Class BC, all urban consumers, not seasonally adjusted, just to be exact. An increase in the city's contribution to the Teamster Security Fund for FY25, and then some other modifications to articles and other agreed upon modifications to conform to the agreement that are going to be retroactive back to July 1st of 2023. So the blue collar labor agreement for the current fiscal year shall be paid from various funds for salary and benefits. Budgeted funds available are $1,463,155, and there's been a budget augmentation of $567,605. So for FY24, That is a 4.25 base wage increase, retroactive back to July 1st of 2023, costing $2,030,760. It also includes an 8% training pay for eligible formal training plans, increased retirement and termination payouts for sick leave, and a police addendum that includes additional uniform and boot allowances, along with rest periods for long overtime shifts. So in FY25, that starts on July 1st of this year, it allows for up to between a 2.25 and a 3.5% base wage increase that would cost somewhere between $1.16 million and up to $1,809,587 if we're at the 3.5 mark, as well as some increased contributions to the Teamsters Security Fund of Southern Nevada Local 14, which is the health fund, of $30 per member per month, costing $184,680. Additionally, as I mentioned, the police addendum includes uniform, boot, and increased allowances. So I just want to take a minute and thank our city team who worked for almost a year to get this, this agreement over this finish line. So a huge thank you to our city team. And I also want to thank Teamsters Local 14 and Tony Freitas and Grant Davis for their work on behalf of the 517 Teamster blue-collar employees that are City of Henderson employees. They've worked hard to help us reach an agreement that their members can support and that we can bring forward to you for approval. I know that they're out of town right now and they would be here if they weren't able to. So thank you so much.
Thank you. And just to be clear, Brooke, this also includes a market study for their wages, is that correct?
Yes, this does allow for a market study for the Teamster blue collar wages so we can see if we're competitive in the market for their wages. Absolutely.
Thank you. Any questions or comments? This is a public hearing. I will now open. If you wish to make a public comment, please come to the podium, speak directly into the mic, and state your name and zip code, and you'll have 3 minutes to speak.
Mayor, there is no one in the public comment queue for this item.
I'll close the public hearing. Any may I have a motion? Please vote.
All council members voted in favor of the motion made by Councilwoman Cox, and it carries.
The next section of your agenda is bills referred from committee for adoption as ordinance. Item 32 is bill number 3777, ZZA-200-666-0051-A3 for Monument at Calico Ridge. Your recommendation is to adopt is ordinance number 4020.
May I have a motion?
I'll move.
Please vote.
All council members voted in favor of the motion made by Councilman Seebach, and it carries.
Item 33 is bill number 3778, amend Henderson Municipal Code, Chapter 2.47, records management. Your recommendation is to adopt as ordinance number 4021.
May I have a motion? Please vote.
All council members voted in favor of the motion made by Councilman Shaw, and it carries.
The next section of your agenda is new business. Item 34 is amended resolution number 4571, amended ballot question to incur general obligation debt and levy additional taxes for fire department facilities, operations, maintenance, personnel, and equipment. Your recommendation is to adopt.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. On March 19th, 2024, the City Council approved Resolution 4571 to provide its notice of intent to place a question on the ballot of the November 5th, 2024 general election of the qualified voters for the City of Henderson for their approval or disapproval of a proposal to incur $27.5 million in general obligation debt to finance construction and improvement of Henderson Fire Department facilities and to levy a special elective tax for Henderson Fire Department operations, maintenance, personnel, and equipment. As there are two components to the ballot question, a general obligation bond and also an operational levy, city staff determined that language in the ballot may not be clear to the voters as to its intent. Specifically, that the numbers provided in the fiscal impact section of the question are inclusive of both a general obligation bond and an operational levy. To clarify that paragraph related to the fiscal impact, minor edits were made and are provided as backup in the agenda. Any fiscal related information, including the revenue study provided to the Debt Management Commission and other fiscal information in the question, require no change. Before you use amended resolution 4571 with the revised ballot question language, staff recommends approval.
Thank you. May I have a motion? Please vote.
All All council members voted in favor of the motion made by Councilwoman Cox, and it carries.
Item 35 is appointments by mayor and council for committee and against committee for the ballot question to ask the city of Henderson voters whether to incur $27.5 million in general obligation debt to finance construction and improvement of fire department facilities and to levy a special elective tax for fire department operations, maintenance, personnel, and equipment. Your recommendation is to appoint.
Thank you. For this item, it looks like we need three for each, and it looks like we have three for the four committee, which would be Jason Andoja, Douglas Hedger, and Heather Marie Stamer. And on the list of against, we have four, which are Marilyn Ann Armanino, Chris Estrella, Tim Brooks, and Rick Smith. Council, do you have any suggestions or comments?
I do. I'll make a motion.
Sure.
For the four committee, I would make a motion that we accept or appoint Jason Andoja, Douglas Hedger, and Heather Marie Stamer. And for the against committee, I make a motion that we appoint Marilyn Ann Armamino, Tim Brooks, and Rick Smith.
That's your motion?
That's my motion.
Please vote. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Just making sure that this Estrella is not included.
Correct.
Got it. Did it freeze?
All council members voted in favor of the motion made by Councilman Stewart, and it carries.
Item 36 is the annual performance evaluation for your city clerk. Your recommendation is to accept.
Mayor and Council, good afternoon. Okay, good afternoon. And for the record, Jose Luis Valdez, City Clerk. And you have before you the City Clerk annual report that provides in-depth performance data and information for your review that is provided in the backup to the informational packet online. I want to thank you for this opportunity to discuss the accomplishments of the City Clerk's office this year. With the support of our Human Resources Director, Brooke Stream, you have been provided performance and data information in the backup and a new form for you to fill out online to provide us with feedback and guidance. The completed forms have been uploaded to the agenda item online, and they are available now for public inspection. I want to thank you for your feedback and your guidance on that. I am pleased to report that this past year has been incredibly successful. In July, we celebrated winning the National Freedom Award from the National Association of Election Officials, as well as the graduation of April Parra, Kristen Harrell, and myself from the prestigious Certified Elections Registration Administrator Program. Henderson is the only city with three CERA certified elections officials in the entire state. Nathan Hill continues to manage the Archives and Records Division, and he now leads the Henderson City Clerk's effort to create a one-stop shop to manage public records requests. After last summer's reorganization, completion of public records requests for DSC walk-in customers that are managed by Mr. Hill's office increased from 59% to 89% within 1 week's time. Nathan's group also submitted a winning application with Boulder City for Henderson's designation as a World War II Heritage City. Congratulations, Nathan, and thank you for your phenomenal leadership. Council and Commission Services is now under the leadership of CCS Manager April Parra, who brings extensive knowledge, education, experience to her new role. April is currently working on a comprehensive policy and procedure manual and a departmental handbook that we will present to you later this year for your approval. April will also begin scheduling quarterly boards and commission briefings with Mayor and Council to keep you abreast of the many activities that are happening in the community amongst our boards and commissions. Thank you, April, for your dedication and your excellence. Kristen Harrell, our City Clerk's Operations Manager, has been a leader of tremendous character and dedication. Under her stewardship, our City Passports Division completed 14,340 passport applications last year while maintaining a 97% customer satisfaction rating. She was also instrumental in documenting process improvements for a hybrid appointment schedule and a pending customer action queue at Passports, both winners of the city's Path to Premier Award. Congratulations, Kristen. We were also pleased to present the city's first elections administration policy and procedure manual. Our CCS manager, April Parra, who was then serving as elections administrator, drafted the entire document herself, working closely with our partners in the city attorney's office and Parks and Recreation. Kudos to both April and Kristen for bringing this document to fruition, and many congratulations for that work. With April's transition to her new role as manager of council and commission services, Kristen and Julie Chapman, our new elections administrator, are now busily preparing for a June primary and November general elections. In administrative services, providing premier customer service is a daily priority for our executive assistant, Amy Johnson, and proof of her team's success is in this year's numbers. Last year, administrative services assisted approximately 32,000 telephone customers on the main telephone operator line, and they directed 3,396 City Hall customers to the right place. Amy also started the City Hall Accelerator Volunteer Program that helps provide front desk coverage at City Hall with many volunteers. Thank you, Amy, and the entire administrative services team for your dedication in keeping us on track and for helping making sure that I am always on track and on task. We already shared the information about Passport services. I do want to point out that in Passports, we continue to be the only agency that provides a hybrid system of walk-in appointments or a walk-in service and appointments for customers from all over the valley and all over the state. We also get a number of out-of-state visitors, which accounts for a significant part of our revenue in the city clerk's office. So I wanted to make sure that you had that information available in front of you. And as a special note, Mayor and Council, I would be remiss if I did not mention the loss of our longtime and beloved teammate, Moab Dorsey, last summer, who worked for many years in the Development Services Records Division. To know Mo was to love him, and to love Mo means that we miss him, and we ask that you please keep him and his family in your prayers. As City Clerk, I am most pleased with our contributions involving process improvements and written policies in the areas of public records requests, elections, agenda management, governance, and Passports. We have done so while providing the highest level of customer service to all of our internal and external customers. But Mayor and Council, none of this would be possible without your direct support. Thank you, Mayor Romero, Mayor Pro Tem Seebach, Councilwoman Cox, Councilman Shaw, and Councilman Stewart for your incredible support. It is a true blessing and a privilege to be at your service. And thank you to the best city manager in America, Richard Derrick, who provided me with the opportunity to attend the ICMA Professional Development Academy online. I'm pleased to report that I graduated along with several of my city colleagues, including Mr. Dichter behind me, and I think Ms. Rodriguez in the audience somewhere, and Deputy Police Chief Boucher as well. And I want to thank the best city attorney in America, even though he's not here today, Nick Vaskoff. Nick has been a true professional and an honest broker, providing fair and honest legal advice. He and his team have been especially helpful with our elections preparations and with undertaking the extensive responsibilities of managing public records as we move forward. And I want to thank all my colleagues in the city departments, the senior executive team, and to my phenomenal city clerk team who is here wearing the buttons that are showing the bobblehead, never missing an opportunity to be self-depreciating mayor, that is now known as Little Louie, and they're walking around with those buttons. So I thank them all for their steadfast support, because they are the ones who truly make the city clerk's office incredibly special. Submitted for your review, respectfully, the city clerk, Jose Luis Valdez.
Thank you, Louie. That's a special touch. Little Louie is a special addition to a city council meeting, and I expect him at all future council meetings. As I discussed with you earlier, as we were going over your performance evaluation, I am so pleased with the work that you have done in the clerk's office. You have brought a level of professionalism with the certifications and your ICMA designations, the regulations that you've put into effect, just to have documentation of how things should be happening in the city are unprecedented, and they're very much appreciated. It
gets rid of the uncertainty and makes very clear the things that the clerk's office needs to do, the things that the council needs to do in their meetings, and it's very appreciated. Your team handled the special election so far surpassing expectations that it really, you probably set yourself up for a big problem, because now everybody in the Valley is going to be looking to you on how to run elections in the future. You did, your whole team did a phenomenal job. We had no hiccups. We had better turnout than expected. It ran so smoothly that we had people complimenting us on our process, and it just made we'd never done it before, and it made that situation very easy to maneuver, and it was very appreciated by staff and by the public in general. Your team continues to provide exceptional support to mayor and council during our meetings and in other situations. We can always count on you, no matter what's going on behind the scenes. To the public, we always have a seamless meeting going forward without any hiccups, and you have done a really great job of cross-training all of your people so that if anybody's ever absent, there is always somebody who knows how to do the job, which we also didn't have much of in the past, and I appreciate the forethought of making sure that there are people who can do every job in your department, regardless of who's there. I am really grateful that you have taken on the role. And again, this is, I don't know if whether to give you congratulations or my condolences, but to take on the public records process for the city, it is a humongous undertaking, and it is a significant change in the scope of your responsibilities. And you have done so with open arms, with a positive attitude, and you have brought excitement to your team about this new challenge. I believe you have the ability to streamline the records process and to fix the backlog that we've had building for quite some time now. I think it will bring a level of certainty to how the process works so that we're not pinging people all over the place. It's through one steady process that will help us react to our requests much, much faster. Your contract in the past has only been for 1 year at a time, and I feel like it's important that we bring stability. And so my request to the Human Resources Department is to put together a 3-year contract so that we have continuous leadership from your department. And with this in mind, I'm also, because of the tremendous increase in your scope of work, I'm asking for the multi-year contract to include an increase in your pay, and your recommending your annual salary be increased to $189,000 in the coming contract year. With that, I would open it up to a council for any comments they might have on your performance, but thank you for that presentation, and thank you for the work that you've all done.
I'm in full support of that. You've done an incredible job. I will add one condition to it. The tamales are really good. So,
Tashaw, I must apologize. Mom had surgery this past spring, so those are still pending. I've not forgotten those.
No, in all seriousness, you've done a great job, and you've taken on additional responsibility, and we appreciate your leadership and how you've really gathered support in your department and streamlined it. So thank you for all you do. We appreciate that a lot.
Louis, thank you. I echo everything and double what the mayor and Councilman Shaw have said, but what little bit I want to say is that you do your job with excellence, and your whole team does, but you're just really a great guy. You know what? Just to be around you, I love our briefings every month, and you are a gentleman with very, very high integrity, and I really appreciate that, so thank you.
Louis, I just have to tell you, I have little Louis on. I'm totally a supporter. You are fabulous, and I would echo everything that's been said. Anytime there's an increase in pay for anyone in the city, I always take a moment to think about what that means, what that message is, and where all of our other employees are. So I think of the city as a whole rather than individuals. You definitely deserve, with your taking on, as the mayor's already talked about, the election process is just amazing, what your team and what you have done, and you're taking on a whole new, huge, in my thoughts, it's just huge that you're taking on public records too. So I think you're very deserving of your increase and of the pay that you will receive, and I do support it. In my thinking about that, I did need to look at those things carefully because it concerned me that there are people that work for us that maybe haven't had a raise in, you know, in years and things like that. And so one of the things that I have been really happy about, and I need to thank Brooke Stream because she's phenomenal as well, and HR is definitely looking at all of our pay and how that in all the groups and how that shapes up for them. And that really made me feel really good about saying, okay, I can support it, because that's my question, is can we afford it? And is it fair across the board? And so I appreciate HR stepping in and doing that, but I couldn't be more supportive of saying you're phenomenal, and I definitely support the increase and a three-year contract. So thank you so much for all you do.
Lastly, I get to speak last here. Thank you for what you do. What I find really commendable for you is you're constantly asking how to get better, and you take feedback to heart, and you apply it. But on top of that, you have a team that's like no other, a camaraderie. I just sit up here watching, laugh. I see number one signs out there. I see jokes and smiles, and it's a sign of a good team. And you're about to take on a tremendous amount of work, responsibility, and for the all that comes with it with the public records. So hats off to all of you, to your team, for taking on that challenge. And I look forward to supporting you throughout moving forward with helping that this whole council does. So thank you for your leadership, and thank you for the entire team over there.
Would somebody like to make a motion?
Yeah. I'll move to approve what the mayor lined out relative to the salary increase. And thank you again.
Thank you.
What do you want to do? We didn't talk about a bonus.
If it's okay, I'm going to amend the motion.
Yeah. I forgot.
And add a $5,000 bonus.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Dan. I'll accept that motion. Sorry, I forgot that.
May I have a vote, please?
All council members voted in favor of the motion made by Councilman Stewart, and it carries.
Item 37 is a presentation for the City of Henderson's tentative budget for fiscal year 2024-2025. Your recommendation is to accept.
Good afternoon, Mayor and Council. We have a presentation for you today on the fiscal year 2025 tentative budget. My name is David Weiser. I am the Assistant Director of Finance. As I said, today is just the presentation. On May 21st will be our public hearing on the budget. So with that, we'll get started. As always, we're proud here at the City of Henderson that we have the lowest property tax rate among major Nevada cities at 77 cents per $100 of assessed valuation. That's nearly 20 cents lower than our next major competitor, the City of Reno, and significantly lower than both the City of Las Vegas and the City of North Las Vegas as well. So we're able to do more with less, but yet still provide premier customer service, as evidenced by our low employee-to-citizen ratio, which shows that we're very efficient at what we do at only 6.6 employees per 1,000 residents. Some financial considerations as we built the fiscal year 2025 budget include the fact that we are seeing slowing growth in particular, growth in our largest revenue source, which is consolidated tax. This budget includes only a 1% growth rate for the upcoming fiscal year, while at the same time, we are seeing increased cost pressures throughout the city. And that's particularly in relation to wage increases. As you're aware, the labor market is very tight, and we're doing everything we can to ensure that we are competitive in our wages as well. As with any budget, our requests simply exceed our available resources. We would love to be able to fund every single program and position that our departments have a need for. That being said, we need to be strategic in how we allocate those available resources, which is why we rely on your strategic plan, the city's key priorities, to guide us. And another reason why you'll see a major investment into public safety in the coming slides as well. Total general fund revenue for fiscal year 2025 is anticipated to be $388.8 million. That represents a 2% increase over our fiscal year 2024 estimate. Our largest revenue source is consolidated tax, which, as you know, is primarily sales tax based. In excess of 90% of that is sales tax based, so it can be highly volatile to how well the local economy is doing. In addition to that, we have property tax at 28% of general fund revenue. So between those two revenue sources, you're looking at 73% of general fund revenue dedicated to those two sources. The next larger items are franchise fees at 11% and charges for services at 8%. Assessed valuation was a bright spot for this year's budget. It increased by 12%, going from $20.2 billion to $22.7 billion for fiscal year 2025. Now, we normally would not anticipate property tax to increase one-for-one in correlation with this due to the property tax caps. However, the data that we've been provided by the Nevada Department of Taxation does indicate a 12% increase in property tax as well. And this is due to all the new development that we are seeing come on our property tax rolls. In addition to that, we believe, thanks to the new development as well, that we will see slightly higher than our fiscal year 2024 estimate as well. So the property tax caps are at 3% for residential and 8% for commercial for fiscal year 2025. The blue bar you see there is the property taxes that we receive. So for fiscal year 2025, we're anticipating $123.5 million in property taxes to the city. The orange bar is the amount that's being abated. So we have $51.2 million that we are not receiving due to those property tax caps. As we mentioned, consolidated tax is our largest revenue stream, and we saw a huge boom in consolidated tax during the COVID pandemic due to the rush of fiscal stimulus. That has moderated significantly. As you can see, fiscal year 2024, we are only anticipating a 3.5% growth rate, and that's including large events such as the Super Bowl and Formula One. Well, for fiscal year 2025, only a 1% increase going from there. So these numbers are consistent with the revenue estimates provided to us by the Nevada Department of Taxation. So in total general fund revenue, we're looking at a 2% growth from fiscal year 2024 estimates, which is one reason why consolidated tax is really outweighing that growth rate in property tax that we saw. Total general fund expenditures are anticipated to be $392.9 million. On the left-hand side is the general fund expenditures broken out by function. So we're dedicating 58% of general fund expenditures to public safety, followed by general government and culture and recreation as our top three expenditure functions. The right-hand pie chart is the same general fund expenditures. This time it's just broken out by account category. But same general fund expenditures to illustrate the fact that between salaries and benefits, we're looking at 79% of general fund expenditures are dedicated to essentially people, which makes sense. As you know, we are a people-driven business, whether it's police, fire, human resources. That being said, that is one reason why we are seeing increased cost pressures given the tight labor market that we are in today. And one reason why we wanted to provide you with a quick union update here today as well, because these bargaining groups do represent the vast majority of those salaries and benefits. First and foremost, we have the Henderson Police Officers Association, the HPOA. We are currently having ongoing discussions with them to address the recruitment and retention issues that we are seeing in our police department. As you're aware, we recently implemented the critical labor shortage. We're hoping the outcome of the conversations we're having with them right now will help to ensure that we are market competitive with Metro and City of North Las Vegas in the years to come. In addition to that, we have the International Association of Firefighters. We have currently a tentative agreement with them, which their membership is pending ratification of. We believe once approved, this tentative agreement will ensure that we are market competitive, not just for our firefighters and firefighter paramedics, but also our paramedic ambulance operators as well. Teamsters Blue Collar was just approved, and the other contracts are good through June 30th of 2025. With that, I'd like to get into the fun stuff, which is our budget highlights. First and foremost, we are fiscally sustainable. We're very proud to say that we are fully reserved for fiscal year 2025. We have anticipated 10.5% of ending fund balance of our general fund revenue in our general fund. So this is a best practice at this is a best practice from the Government Finance Officers Association. So we're maintaining that best practice. In addition to that, though, we also have our rainy day fund. This is our financial stabilization reserve fund, and that is an additional 8.3% of general revenues set aside. Our budget this year aligns with the city's strategic priorities, as you'll see in the coming slides, while still having that low property tax rate among major Nevada cities. And yet we still are able to provide such premier customer service with that low employee to citizen ratio. So just recurring the theme that we're able to do more with less, but yet still being premier. For community safety, starting with the fire department, as you're aware, we added 33 new positions for Fire Station 92. Those positions started in March for the academy. This budget includes a full year of staffing to bring those positions on. And then in addition to that, we have our fire station renovations. This is Station 81 and Station 82. So those renovations are built into next year's budget as well. And then recruitment and retention, as I mentioned, we currently have a tentative agreement that we hopefully will get passed, and that will ensure that we are market competitive as it relates to wages to ensure that we're recruiting and retaining the best people possible. For the police department, we're adding 9 new positions to staff the Inspirata Police Station. In addition to that, we've added positions at the detention center during this fiscal year that will continue on for a full year staffing in 2024 as well. We've also, the police department is planning to implement a new cadet program. This will help bridge the gap between the Henderson Explorers program and ultimately there'll be an opportunity for them to have a paid cadet to ultimately become a full-time police officer. So this is a great opportunity for us to funnel the best potential candidates into full-time positions and to help address our recruiting issues. In addition, we have the animal control renovations. This additional dollar set aside to handle issues identified at the animal control shelter, and we've added 5 full-time positions during the current fiscal year that will continue on into next year's budget as well. And then recruitment and retention, as I mentioned, we do have those ongoing discussions with the HPOA, so we're very hopeful that those will come to fruition, in which case we'll be market competitive. But those conversations have been built into this budget. Healthy, livable, sustainable communities. We have dedicated funding for our downtown park renovation. This is phase 1 of the project. We are anticipating additional grant funds to implement phase 2. We have recurring funding for public art in the parks as well, built into the budget. For housing stability, we have our Henderson Homeless Response Team. This was COVID dollars that we received, one-time COVID dollars that our team has been very innovative in being able to extend these out through fiscal year 2025 to kind of bridge that gap for the future. In addition to that, we have the Housing Development Incentive Program, where our team will provide fee waivers for housing developers to build affordable housing units here in Henderson as well. We're also adding a position as a habitability inspector. And then under climate response initiative, we are adding operating dollars to help our sustainability manager in our citywide climate action plan. For quality education, as you're aware, we're currently in the process of applying to be a sponsorship of charter schools here in the state of Nevada. This budget includes startup costs for that, including two new positions that will help to facilitate that program. And I'm proud to say that those positions are being funded through the marijuana money, the education set aside. In addition, we have the economic vitality grant funding, so one-time dollars for our target industry funding that will continue on into fiscal year 2025 as well. And then under high-performing public service, we are adding a recreation and recruitment specialist. This position will help our Parks and Recreation Department address recruitment issues as it relates to filling part-time seasonal positions during the summer season. And then, of course, continued funding to our Performance Excellence Program as well. In total, staffing additions for fiscal year 2025 include 28 new positions, half of which are in public safety. And we are very fortunate to receive funding from the More Cops Funds. This is a special revenue source that gives us a slice of the sales tax dedicated to hiring and equipping new police officers. Outside of public safety, we're adding two positions in Parks and Recreation, three positions in Public Works, which is primarily facility maintenance based, as well as two positions in information technology. These positions are really just to keep up with existing growth that we have had here in the city with all the new facilities and new parks that we've added online. As I mentioned, two new positions for education. These are being funded through our cannabis set aside dollars within the general fund. As far as capital improvement projects, we were very fortunate to leverage our city's excellent credit rating during this fiscal year to issue new bonds. And the projects you see here are mostly due to the bond proceeds of that. So we have Fire Station 92 in West Henderson, Fire Station Renovations 81 and 82, Animal Control. And then under Healthy, Livable, Sustainable Communities, we have the West Henderson Fieldhouse, the Downtown Park Renovation, and the West Henderson Maintenance Yard and Superdump. All those projects are from the issuance of bond proceeds. So we were very fortunate to take advantage of our great credit rating there. For a new project, we have the Arroyo Grande Sports Complex renovation that will help to address issues identified out there. And then we have our Early Education Center, which is being funded from the 18% RDA set aside for education. As far as next steps go, the tentative budget is posted online for the public to view. As of today, my team and I will go back and finalize the budget at this point, and then on May 21st will be our public hearing and hopefully adoption of this budget, and then June 1st would be our deadline to file. So with that, I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, David. Council, do you have any questions, Councilwoman?
Really quick, do you know when the More Cops funds sunset?
Previously, it was scheduled to sunset in 2026, but that was removed, I believe it was in the 2019 legislative session. So there's currently no sunset on those funds.
Awesome. And I am so excited about the startups of sponsorships for charter schools. That is such a huge deal. Thank you. I'm so glad that's in the budget. Appreciate it. Appreciate all your hard work.
Thank you.
So just some feedback to you and to the city manager, and I expressed it in my individual briefing. So with some of the funds, especially as I go around in the community, I really do like the added personnel. It's actually a good cross-section of the entire city, because what we can never forget is we are customer service driven. And so providing those extra bodies helps with that customer service, especially when I look at public works and as the ever-going issues with traffic and everything, adding to that them makes a big difference. But what I would ask is, I know it's not quite finalized yet, but a continued investment past just grants towards our affordable housing as well as our homeless response and our ability to somehow get that into our general budget, because we're doing okay. But I want us to stay in front of that as far as the funding and the commitment to continue to address those issues. as we move forward, because that is what I hear commonly from the community is issues such as that. So thank you.
Thank you.
First of all, thank you for all your work. I think it's putting together a city budget that's this large is very complicated and very time consuming, and I appreciate that. I do think there's two or three things that the general public should know about our budget. One is, as you mentioned, we have an incredible bond rating, and that allows us to do capital improvement projects that the city needs and provides adequate funding and lead time for us to get those projects done. Because we are on very solid financial footing, that bond rating continues to improve, and it also allows us to control how much bonding capacity we have, and the public needs to know that we have not overextended in any way. We're well within our limits on bond funding. Reserves, I want to just spend just a second on that. You touched on that. We do try to maintain a 10% of our general fund budget. Just so people put that in perspective, that's about, what, $36 million. And our rainy day fund is about 8%, so that would be roughly in the $25 million range that we maintain in cash, set aside, just in case. So we're on real firm ground. The other thing I want to point out, only because I present things maybe a little bit different, is we show an abated amount on our tax revenue. The reality is we're never ever going to get that. So that's funds that might be shown on that slide, but that's not coming to us, and it's never going to happen. Unless you can convince your legislators to change their point of view, which has been tried now for several years and hasn't happened. The other thing I want to really emphasize is we spend a lot of time on police and fire and public safety, but every department in our city is critically important to us. And I want all of our staff to understand and know that we're aware of your needs, we're working really hard, and that you are on equal, if not better, ground than police and fire in getting funding so that your needs are well taken care of. We recognize that as we grow, that is a challenge, always, to hire people and maintain our budgets. But every department is very critical to us. I think the other thing that the general public needs to know is this is a budget of the city, but the city maintains what are termed enterprise funds, which are not included in this budget. For example, water and sewer. That is a kind of a standalone business that generates its own revenue, has bonding, and does all that thing all by itself. And we do review those budgets. They are public, and everyone sees that. We saw redevelopment here tonight, which is another one of those types of funds. So as we pull all of these together, the dollars that we're talking about are very large dollars. But I want the public to rest assured that our staff, our city management, is into those details, as well as our council. We are briefed and we understand where those dollars go, we understand what those budgets are, and we are very cautious, and we appreciate your conservative approach. A 1% increase is very conservative, and I think that's appropriate. So thank you for your time and efforts.
Thank you.
David, thank you for a very professional presentation. It's incredible to think about how much work goes into this 10 or 15 minute presentation here tonight. So thank you, appreciate that. You think about all the needs every year, that legitimate needs that come before city management from all the departments, and be able to squeeze what we can out of every dollar. That's very impressive. So kudos to management and the entire team for getting the most out of the citizens' dollars that we can. So thank you.
Thank you for that presentation. Thanks to your whole team. I know that this is a months and months and months long effort. And I want to remind everybody that the city experiences cost pressures as well. We are experiencing inflation just like everybody else is. So everything from our supplies that our public works department has to buy to our people, everything is increasing. And inflation, and in some cases for some of the things we have to buy, has gone up four times what the cost was compared to last year. When you match that with the fact that we're only getting a 2% increase in revenues, that puts a lot of pressure on our budget and a lot of responsibility to make sure that we are identifying every dollar coming in, that we know where it is and where it's going. We also need to identify any other streams of income we can possibly get to make sure that we are having as stable a budget as we possibly can. Even when the economy is going up and down, we need to have that stability, which is why we earlier were talking about the tax override that we're going out to the public for. We have to have a steady stream of income for those people who are have minimum staffing requirements. At the same time, we have to make sure that we are competitive in our salaries that we're paying. So we are doing the analysis, the market analysis, to make sure that we are paying a fair wage to our people, that we're competitive, so that we continue to get this stellar people that we have now. And we need more people. Every department that we've talked to is understaffed to some degree, and we need to make sure. So the task that's been put before you is Herculean, for lack of a better word. So I appreciate the fact that you're thinking about all these things, and you're thinking about the future and how next year we may only get a 1% increase, and how are we going to manage these funds in a manner that is responsible, that's responsive to the needs of the community and responsive to the needs of our employees. And I appreciate the thought that has gone into that and the work that's being done to identify those other avenues of revenue. We also need to go back to looking at the total cost of doing business. What does it really mean when we put a new, when we get a new facility, for example? Because it's not just the people in the facility, it's the operation of the facility, it's the ongoing maintenance, it is the janitors that have to clean that facility, and on and on and on and on for maintenance. So we might need to be very aware of how those costs are impacting future budgets as well. And this is something I know you already have. As you said before, there is a long list of requests and a short budget. And so sometimes we get extra revenue coming in. The state sometimes is very conservative in what they predict. So I really ask us to look at, on a regular basis, what that priority list is and make sure that we are keeping current with that. So if we do get the opportunity to get other revenue coming in, that we're able to address some of these other issues that maybe have been pushed down the list that are still really, really important, that are things that we need but didn't quite make the cut this year. And then finally, it may already be in the budget, but one thing, when you come back for the next time, I would like to make sure we, right now, in order for somebody to do an application for a development project, they have to print out a form, fill it out, scan it in, and then we can look at it electronically, which in my opinion is ridiculous. We need to be able to go to a fully automatic application online system so that we can track those development requests coming in, that we can make sure that every department involved in that development application has access to it. So if there's an issue, all the departments are aware of that issue and can respond accordingly. So I would ask, when you come back, if you can let me know if that is in the budget and make sure that we get that.
Yes, absolutely. We'll come back. We'll work with city management on determine the best path forward. So thank you.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it. May I have a motion to accept? Thank you. Please vote.
All council members voted in favor of the motion made by Councilman Stewart, and it carries.
Item 38 is a resolution to amend the City of Henderson capitalization threshold. Your recommendation is to adopt.
Good afternoon, Mayor and Council. Marie Gamboa, Director of Finance. The item before you is a resolution to amend the City of Henderson capitalization threshold. The last update to this resolution was in 2007. Due to inflation, the growth of the city has experienced since then. It is necessary for us to update the threshold to maintain a similar level of resource dedication to capital assets and also to bring the city in alignment with current accounting standards. The resolution would update the capitalization threshold for an individual asset from $10,000 to $20,000 and would also add a bulk purchase capitalization threshold of $50,000. So that would be new.
Thank you. Any questions or comments? May I have a motion?
All council members voted in favor of the motion made by Councilman Seebach, and it carries.
Now is the time for mayor and council member comments. Are there any comments? Councilman?
I can make my... Go ahead. No, go. I just want to thank all of our staff, and I want them to know, and I've said it many times, so if you don't feel it, let me know, and I'll make sure that I do a better job at it. We do have an incredible staff in Henderson, some of the best, and are with us. And I really hope you know how incredibly grateful and thankful I am to rub shoulders with each one of you. And I feel it an honor and a privilege to do so. So thank you for all you do. And especially, I don't know if I recognized your team, Louie, in a great way, but they are phenomenal. Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
I just want to take a moment to, over the weekend, we saw what happened. A tremendous amount of work went into trying to save a life and also take someone into custody at the same time by our police departments. And it was a great cooperation between all the police departments. And through it all, no one was harmed, except unfortunately for that person that was involved. But it was a great job of caring for our community and going after a very bad person. And so it was a great job by the police department. But on that same note, I also want to commend the police department because they also caught some individuals that were, my words, terrorizing a church and scaring those attendees and members. And so just great follow-up, great investigative work on that. Great job at that standoff to our police department. And finally, I know they're all gone and they missed this exciting meeting that we have. But it's also National Public Safety Telecommunications Week. In other words, our dispatchers. So I want to say thank you to them and the job that they do that sometimes gets overseen. And so a tremendous amount of work goes into those jobs and making our city successful. So thank you for all those people involved from this weekend.
Thank you. Anything else? I will set the next city council and committee and regular meetings for May 7th, 2024. And now is the time for our final public comment. If you wish to make a public comment, please come to the podium, speak directly into the mic, and state your name and zip code. You will have 3 minutes to speak.
Mayor, we have two people registered. The first person is Mr. Randy Poole, who would like to speak about Rainbow Canyon.
Good afternoon, Mayor and Council members. I thank you for having me here. I am a resident of what's known as Marble Mesa, and that is area code 89011. And with it, I've been there with my wife, Marlene, for the last year and a half, year plus. We are now looking at the subdivision, and it's currently known as Rainbow Canyon Partial M-1B Phase 2. So for the folks that work in community development as well as public works, give you an idea. I've met with many of your folks, and I really appreciate it, and I'll thank them at the end. We are trying to inspect to see what's supposed to be provided. You as our fiduciary responsible party to make sure that we get what we paid for, whether it be the street lights or the sewer systems or whatever it might be. In our case, we are, in my opinion, as an engineer, having looked at the system. And that's one of the problems too, is the fact that only an engineer or an architect can actually receive the plans and specs review what we're supposed to be getting because of the Homeland Security laws that I remember dealing with in my public arena for the last 35 years, such that not everybody could have those documents. So I've taken it upon myself to look at it. There are some deficiencies that the developer is not undertaking correctly, whether it be the renovation plans and specs or the landscaping or even the gate that's supposed to be at the front of the project or even where the developer above us to the north, Raintree Development at the Pass Peak Development, is leveling the mountainside down to where it looks like they're going to tie into our current street of Ta-Nehisi Point Street, such that we're supposed to be a private controlled community in such that we would not be wanting to have that development driving through our community as well. And so I would like to suggest that, well, there's also a completely plugged storm drain on the site that's such that the floodwaters now top the detention basin and spill out into the middle of the street, which happened last year about this time. The key thing I'm looking at is the fact that we're talking about trees and plants, which is very easy to count. A storm drain is easy to fix. But I'd like to sit down and have an honest discussion with the staff to make sure that we're on the same page as to what is not currently being fixed by, or actually corrected by, the developer for our project, because I suspect within the next year they're going to be completed. And so therefore, I'd like to have that meeting. I'm also asking that this is really a due diligence demand for performance type request to you as our fiscal agent to make sure we get those things. We are also looking at, you know, I'm trying to get the course. Want me to stop?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Thank you. So if anybody could contact me, I'd sure appreciate it.
Thank you. We'll have somebody from Public Works contact you.
Next person is Sean Thibault.
Good evening, folks. Sean Thibault, Henderson Police Officers Association, 89015. As Councilman Seabock mentioned earlier, this was a pretty intense weekend for the membership. Pretty violent. And I wanted to recognize the fact that yourself and the mayor were out there publicly supporting our police officers out there. You did it without any expectations of that. But it does not go unnoticed. And I wanted to read you something. I got this text earlier today from one of the senior officers on scene. He says, as being one of the people out there, it's appreciated to have the recognition of you, and thank you for sharing what our mayor had stated. Little things like simply acknowledging the hard work people did on this goes a long way. He goes on to say, I've never seen so many people so exhausted, yet still performing their duties to the highest level. It's not unnoticed by a lot of us out there. So that comes from one of our officers that were actually on scene working that night. I also would be remiss that if I did not recognize my man down here, Big Louie, for his for his accomplishments. Louie's leadership and mentorship goes beyond his own staff and his doorways down there at City Clerk's office. When I was first thinking about coming into this position, he told me, "Don't do it." he actually encouraged me. He said, "Go forth and conquer." He shared some kind words with me, mentored me along the way. It's something that I'll never forget, and I appreciate that, Louie. Thank you very much. So well deserved. You guys got a great city clerk. We all have a great city clerk. Lastly, I would like to thank the chief for working so diligently with all of you and working on the public records issues and finally coming to some type of resolution on that. You're putting, in my opinion, the right man in charge of that, and he's definitely going to bring some structure, stability, and integrity to the process. And we're looking forward to that. We appreciate it. So recognition to all of you, Louie, the chief. Appreciate you very much. Thank you.
With that, I'll close the public hearing, and I will adjourn the regular meeting at this time.